Our world has been on a continuous and progressive path of economic evolution for many centuries now.
From the days of plowing the soil with sticks, to the days of the animal-drawn plows, through to the invention of the tractors, one thing remained clear. Our world survives on entrepreneurship.
Entrepreneurial success, however, rests on the twin pillar of people and action. With the majority of the African population struggling to make ends meet, there is a dire need to equip these people with a passion to take action, else economic emancipation will be all but an illusion.
Located in Western Africa, Ghana, the first country in sub-Saharan Africa to gain independence in 1957, has over the years achieved great feats. As a nation blessed with oil and gold reserves, as well as many fertile lands, we have taken steps to exploit our natural resources, which has pegged us as amongst the world's largest producers of gold and cocoa.
Rich in diverse culture that originates from 46 different ethnic groups, Ghana has a population of about 26 million and a per capita income of $1,696.08. With a daily minimum wage of $2.2, the average Ghanaian can buy for himself a sizable meal of breakfast and lunch, although this amount may seem meager to majority of us.
Hailing from the nation's premier university, we, Enactus University of Ghana, have over the past 15 years embarked on over 50 projects, which have benefited over 2,000 persons. This year, we set out on a quest for emancipation and transformation through entrepreneurship. Our desire was to help shape the lives of the less privileged and the all but forgotten members of the society, which is in line with the 2015 World Bank report on poverty reduction in Ghana.
This year, we present to you two projects, Hope for the Future and Match Life. As a force of change,
we impact lives.
We create opportunities.
We strive for equality. And
we are Enactus University of Ghana.
Honorable judges, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, our first project, Hope for the Future.
The World Health Organization estimates that approximately 3 million Ghanaians suffer from mental disorders. The treatment deficit, however, as reported by the Ghana News Agency in 2013, is a whopping 97% of this number. Despite all the challenges pertaining to mental health care, discharge patients still suffer negative stereotyping associated with mental illnesses.
Overcrowding is not an astonishing sight in most Ghanaian hospitals, even in the psychiatric ones. According to a report by MyJoyOnline.com in 2012, the Accra Psychiatric Hospital, a facility meant to cater for 300 patients, now caters for a whopping 1,700 patients, with 1,200 completely abandoned by relatives, thus unaccepted into society. With this increase in pressure, the hospital is unable to meet its debt settlements, even to its food suppliers.
In keeping with our long-held principle of bringing hope where there appears to be none, we started the Hope for the Future project at the Accra Psychiatric Hospital in January 2015. This project was to be accomplished in three major phases. Phase one, equipping the treated patients with income-generating vocational skills. Phase two, renovating the defunct occupational therapy units of the hospital. And phase three, facilitating the reintegration into society of the treated patients. In our needs assessment, we realized the necessity to equip them with a vocation that could easily be learned, does not require huge startup capital, and has a ready market.
After a detailed research, we found out that the skill in beach stringing was a suitable vocation for these patients. Five treated patients were selected to undergo a 2-week intensive training by SNAM, a resource person. The training began from the 9th of April to the 23rd of April 2015. The results? Fascinating! This patient displayed sheer creativity and a great deal of skill in the art of bead stringing by producing beautiful and attractive jewelry. This phase was proudly sponsored by Opportunity International Savings and Loans Company.
After the training, an exhibition was organized at the hospital to showcase and sell the bead products made by the project's participants. In attendance were businesses, students, and the media. Impressed by what the project participants had made, Business Factory Initiative for Africa, BUFIA, invested a whopping amount of $5,077 to facilitate the large-scale production of the bead jewelry. Other exhibitions were organized at schools and churches.
This year, our assessment showed that occupational therapy unit, which served as the main production center, had poor lighting, leaky roofs, and was rodent infested.
Unfazed by these challenges, we decided to commence with the second phase of our project by entering into the 2015 Community Service Awards, organized by the Osaikusi Foundation. This award is aimed at encouraging volunteerism among the youth by awarding young people engaged in community service. Our team won the grand prize of $2,538 towards the renovation of the occupational therapy unit. At a cost of $2,284.30, the occupational therapy unit has received a facelift. The leaky roofs have been fixed, the floors screeded, the room cleared of old equipment, the walls painted, electrical wiring, as well as a natural lighting system installed.
Honorable judges, the refurbished occupational therapy unit, OTU, was commissioned on the 17th of June 2016. The aim of renovating the OTU was to provide a convenient and spacious working environment. Among the new facilities is an exhibition room to showcase the work done by patients. 8 additional patients have been enrolled on the training program, thus bringing the number of total participants to 13.
On the average, each participant is able to produce 38 pieces of jewelry per month at a per unit cost of $2.54. At a selling price of $3.81, a per unit profit of $1.27 is raked in upon each sale. Thus, monthly earnings for each beneficiary currently stands at $48.26.
As at October 2015, a total amount of $225.5 had been generated through consistent exhibitions at events such as the Osaikusi Foundation's Community Service Awards and other numerous events on campus. Bead jewelry was also exhibited at a sponsored trip to the Youth Summer Bootcamp in Amsterdam, the Netherlands, where great interest was expressed in them, and sales to the tune of €114, which translates to $127.68, was generated. Bead products raked in a total amount of $597.72 through all these exhibitions. A total amount of $725 has been generated through all these exhibitions. Bead jewelry is also made available on tonaton.com and olx.com.
The beneficiaries were previously unemployed and solely dependent on their relatives and the hospital, now earn a wage of $1.27 per bead product successfully produced. They can now boast of being income earners and are no longer fully dependent on their relatives and the hospital.
The last phase of the project, which is aimed at reintegrating these treated patients back into the society, has begun with the Enactus University of Ghana championing the hashtag H4TF campaign on social media to sensitize the general populace against stereotyping people with mental illnesses. This campaign was also publicized on mainstream media through interviews with Radio Universe, the official radio station of the University of Ghana, as well as our award-winning TV show, City FM Breakfast Show.
To ensure the sustainability of our project, plans are underway to set up a fund for these participants where they get up to set aside a substantial amount of their wages in order to guarantee a startup capital for their own businesses when they leave the hospital. These approaches will go a long way to help us realize our ultimate aim of reintegrating these beneficiaries back into the society where they belong.
And this is how the Hope for the Future project met the triple P requirements of the judging criterion. People.
13 treated patients have been provided with skills in the art of bead jewelry making, as well as a conducive production room to boost their work.
Profits.
Each treated patient makes an average monthly income of $48.50.
And planet.
This project has no negative impact on the environment.
Honorable judges, our next project, Mash Life.
As a developing country, Ghana strives to give its citizens equal opportunities to achieve their dreams as well as aid in national development. but some few members of the society cannot contribute meaningfully to sustainable growth, especially the physically disabled. One common sight that often greets anyone driving through the city of Accra, especially at traffic lights, is the horde of physically disabled persons holding bowls in outstretched arms, looking desperate and dejected, staring at drivers and passengers with imploring eyes, and grateful for the few coins dropped into their bowls.
Apart from the fact that these physically disabled persons are not guaranteed their daily bread, they also live in constant fear of being run over by either a reckless driver or a faulty vehicle.
We've found the situation to be very disturbing and decided to help get as many of these disabled people off the streets. After a careful assessment of the situation, we realized the only way to achieve our goal was to equip these physically disabled people with viable vocational skills on which they could depend for self-sustenance.
In 2015, we agreed on a partnership with the Samuel Wellington Botre Foundation, SWEB, to embark on the Mash Life project. This project involves the growing and harvesting of mushrooms for sale. We settled on mushroom growing for the following reasons. One, it takes an average of 1 week to grow and harvest mushrooms using the substrate bags method, which we employed. Two, mushroom growing requires minimal startup capital and it's very less labor intensive. Three, there is a growing demand for mushrooms in Ghana. And four, there are so many health benefits associated with the consumption of mushrooms, including the regulation of human blood pressure, as well as the lowering of body fat content.
With the help of two non-governmental organizations, Hope for Life and Share Care, 10 physically disabled persons between the ages of 19 and 40 were selected as our project beneficiaries. The first phase of our project involved the comprehensive training of these beneficiaries in mushroom farming. The second phase involved the establishment of grow houses and mushroom production.
At the comprehensive training phase, 10 disabled youth were housed at the Hope for Life Bethany House at Gbawi, where they underwent a two-month holistic training in the growing of oyster mushrooms by a resource person from the Mushroom Growers and Exporters Association of Ghana, MUGREG. We also provided training in building and managing of small and medium-scale enterprises through organized class sessions each week.
The second phase saw each of the 10 beneficiaries receive a fully stocked 1,000 substrate capacity grow house constructed at their residence in order to facilitate the mushroom growing business. Currently, 6 of the beneficiaries have had their grow houses constructed for them.
Through our contact at SWEB, we have been able to secure market for the harvested mushrooms with Tyler Agro Investments, an agro-produce buying and packaging company. On the average, each beneficiary is able to produce 250 kilos of mushrooms per month at a per unit cost of $3.05. At a selling price of $3.80, a per unit profit of $0.75 is realized on each kilo sold. Thus, each beneficiary on the average is able to make a monthly earning of $187.50.
We are also in talks with MUGREG to facilitate the buying and export of the mushroom products so as to increase sales and consequently profits of the project's beneficiaries. This project hopes to include at least 20 more disabled persons by the end of the first quarter of 2017.
Honorable judges, this is how the Mash Life project met the triple P requirement of the judging criteria. People.
10 disabled youth have been empowered in mushroom farming and entrepreneurship.
Profits.
Each project participant earns an average of $187.50 each month.
And planet.
There are no harmful byproducts of the mushroom growing process. The substrates left over after harvesting can be used as a form of natural fertilizer for the soil.
In the end, Enactus University of Ghana has remained loyal to its long-standing tradition of reaching out to the downtrodden and to the forgotten, and transforming them to become valued and cherished members of the Ghanaian society.
By our Mash Life project, we were able to set a group of 10 physically disabled persons off the path of discrimination and poverty onto the path of economic emancipation through mushroom farming.
Our Hope for the Future project has set 13 treated patients on the road to reintegration into society and freedom from the shackles of victimization and stigmatization. All our projects are environmentally friendly. Cumulatively,
177 lives impacted.
5,457 Enactus hours invested.
46 jobs provided.
And a total monthly income of $238.6 is generated through our projects. This is a substantial amount in the Ghanaian economy.
Our journey this year was facilitated by our ever-supportive alumni and sponsors, our faculty advisors, Dr. Samuel Bwame and Dr. George Echampong, continue to provide immense guidance and support to the team. We come from a 53-member team, represented here by Kwatima Edinkra,
Nanama Apia,
Lomayana,
and your name Jomeku, and our IT director, Kabina Otin.
Casting our sights beyond the horizon of hopelessness and despair,
and striving for success in the face of many challenges and obstacles,
we are Enactus University of Ghana, and this is our story.
Thank you. We will now start the question and answer period. Only judges may ask questions. Judges, please stand if you wish to ask a question.
Hi, really great presentation. Just a question for hope for the future. Considering that the beads are sold at exhibition fairs, how do you ensure that the income is consistent?
Thank you very much for the question. So with Hope for the Future, apart from the exhibitions we have, most of our partner organizations also deal with customers. Most of our partner organizations, like the Osei Kusi Foundation, as well as Bufia, they deal with customers. They have customers they deal with. And so at every point in time, when products are available from the bead production, they come and they take them and they go and sell and bring whatever portion they have to bring back into the patients. Yeah.
Great job. You talk about with the Hope for the Future project, how that's been going on for about 21 months. I'd like to understand how long you've been working on Mush Life, and if you can speak to the impact that you've seen, speaking to the independence of the members outside of these projects long term.
Okay, so with Hope for the Future, with the Hope for the Future project, we started in January 2015, and then with the Mush Life project, we started in September last year. That's when we started with our visibility studies and all of that. But the actual training of the first batch of trainees started this year in January. So far we've been able to impact 10 people. So far, yeah.
For your Hope for the Future project, thank you for the presentation, by the way. For your Hope for the Future project, how will you ensure sustainability of the project or scalability of the project beyond the 13 identified current incumbent?
Thank you very much for the question. So for the Hope for the Future project, we are working with the hospital because these are mentally disabled persons, so we can't work with them on our own. So we're working with the hospital. So what we did was to bring a resource person to train their patients, and the nurses in charge of the occupational therapy unit also learned the skills. So these are the ones that they make sure that every month we get more patients to train. Thank you.
Okay, to add to what she said, with sustainability of the project, we are a team of people made up of different levels in the university. So some are in final year, some are in their first years. So when the final year students leave, this project is not going to die. It's going to be handed over to the other teams. And also, because we deal with partner organizations, they are also very much involved in the project, and they see to it that everything runs on smoothly. So it's not only about us.
Again, we also plan on setting up a fund so that whatever amounts that they make, a particular percentage of the amounts that they make is put in an account for them, so that when they leave the hospital, they have an amount with which to start their own bead producing businesses.
Okay, we also have plans of expanding to other psychiatric hospitals in the country. Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit more about that? When the patients do leave the hospital, what have you seen? So they have income in hand and they have a new skill and a trade. What have you observed in terms of their independence? What happens to them once they are released?
Thank you very much for the question. So one reason why it was difficult for them to go out was that, one, there was the stigmatization outside because they've once suffered from mental illnesses. And also their family members didn't want to take them back because they felt like they were becoming financial burdens upon them. And so now that we've been able to reintegrate some of them into the society, we didn't just leave them like that. They now have skills. And so their families are more willing to accept them into the society because they are also bringing something into the house.
I'm assuming you had some challenges in the beginning. Tell us one or two big challenges and how did you overcome it?
Thank you very much for the question. So with the challenges, initially we had an issue of getting sponsorship for our project. But then we decided to look out at entrepreneurship challenges, entrepreneurship ventures. That's where we entered into the Osekusi Foundation. So it was like a competition. We entered so that we can get some fund for our project.
Fantastic job. Could I ask you about scalability? What are the opportunities to expand both of your projects, and what are some of the challenges in impacting more individuals?
So when it comes to the expansion of the projects, so the scalability, with the hospital administration is they are the people who give us the group of patients that we can work with. So as time goes on, as some of the patients learn more skills with their occupational therapy, it's also a way of helping them get better. So as they leave the hospital, more are also added onto the projects. So it's a sort of a cycle. And then also too with terms of, yes, with also the MASH life, that's when...
Thank you. I'm sorry, your time has expired. Judges, please join me in thanking the team from Ghana for their presentation.